Festival. Tonight, the second of two programs by the distinguished pianist Glenn Gould.
Musicians have been doing the sort of thing that I was attempting just now. They've been taking little bits of musical trivia, like that theme from Rodgers and Hammerstein's Sound of Music, and trying to find complicated equations into which, like a common denominator, these tidbits will fit. In fact, there's some part of almost every musician which longs to experiment with the mathematical quantities of music and to find forms in which these quantities can function most successfully. Perhaps the long-time favorite of such forms is that special musical mix which we call the fugue. The fugue is normally conceived in a number of voices, a number of individual lines, which up to a certain point can lead a life of their own. But they must have in common a responsibility to some special material which is examined in the course of the fugue. And consequently, each of the voices are first heard announcing in their most comfortable register the same theme. They do not, however, throughout the length of the piece, continue to follow one another mechanically. Their relationship is not that of the voices in a round or a canon, in which the technical challenge is to see how long a precise imitation of intervals can be kept up without courting harmonic disaster. There is in the fugue a much greater give and take between the voices. They're less robot-like than in a round or a canon. And within certain clearly formulated laws, each voice can go off in some pretty wacky tangents of its own. And it's really in knowing when to indulge and when to curtail these tangents that the great fun of fugue writing lies. Throughout the length of the fugue, the subject which gave rise to it will keep poking up, sometimes in rather unexpected places. There's no limit to the number of times it can be heard from, and even quite a brief fugue. One of Bach's fugues, the D major fugue from the second volume of his Well-Tempered Clavichord, has something like, I lost count, but it's around 114 entries of part of its subject, and the piece takes only about 3 minutes to play. On the other hand, the fugue in E-flat major from the same work, which I'm going to play in a few minutes, and which lasts about the same amount of time, has, I think, only 11 or 12 entries of its main subject. Quite often, after we've been introduced to the subject, it'll begin to associate with one or two or more counter-subjects which seem to have a natural sympathy and tolerance for it, and which make a satisfactory harmony when combined with it. This ability to develop simultaneous combinations of musical lines is called the art of counterpoint. And it's obvious, I suppose, that all fugue composition must be contrapuntal. The reverse, however, is not true. All counterpoint is not fugue. It's quite possible to write in a predominantly contrapuntal manner, a manner which allows a great independence and integrity of voices, without necessarily writing in any circumscribed contrapuntal form like a fugue or a canon. Counterpoint simply defines a type of music which is composed of simultaneous lines, each of a certain autonomy, but which need not, as must happen in the case of fugue, derive from the same material. Let's say, for instance, that I want to combine God Save the Queen with the Star-Spangled Banner. And if I want to combine them together, I'd have to take into consideration at what point they suggest harmonic similarity in their movements, at what points I'd likely have difficulty in maintaining some sort of dialogue between them, what points I'd have to alter one or the other of those lines slightly in order to fit a basic harmony that would be favorable to both of them. And if I took all of these things into consideration, the result might be something like this, and I shudder for what political purpose I could accomplish it. Of awkward awkward moments, but it's not bad. Now, the relation of the subject of a fugue to its counter-subject will be something like that of God Save the Queen to the Star-Spangled Banner in that example. They ought to combine and complement their personalities in a manner which, as Sebastian Bach once said, suggests three or four civilized gentlemen conducting a reasonable conversation. And the conversation that they carry on does not necessarily always deal with particularly imposing matters. It can deal with themes which in themselves are particularly beautiful or noble, just as one may conduct a conversation about a point of philosophy. But one may also conduct conversations about the weather or about the neighbor's children. And consequently, some of the most successful fugues are made out of very ordinary stuff. In fact, in certain cases, the more ordinary the subject, the better. If it's really an awkward tune, it'll peek through the most elaborate harmonies in which the composer surrounds it. Like this strange subject by Scarlatti. That's been dubbed the Cat's Fugue, and you couldn't mistake it very well. On the other hand, if the subject is sort of bland and unimaginative, like the Sound of Music theme that I was quoting before, it'll likely fit into a far greater number of situations than if it's too nervous and jumpy and full of strange intervals. So it's almost axiomatic, then, that for a certain kind of fugue, the subject matter has value in inverse proportions to its native perfection, its completeness as melody. Can you imagine anyone trying to make a fugue out of the theme of the last movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony? So complete as a theme by itself that even Beethoven had trouble developing that one. Perhaps the common denominator which links all composers who've engaged in contrapuntal writing is a fondness for motivic experimentation. They love to take a motive and examine it upside down, backwards, forwards, compressed together, elongated, and all without violating its basic shape. Now, all of these motivic experiments are really part of the vocabulary of the Renaissance. It's from the music of the 14th and 15th and 16th centuries that we've learned the tricks of seeing many different facets of the same musical object. And to the later Renaissance particularly, we owe the concept of motivic compromise, the understanding that when one voice follows another ad infinitum, there must eventually be a certain conciliation. The great writers of canon have always known when to quit. One adds additional voices to a work, the problems multiply. And in a work like this Madrigal by Marenzio, we find a good example of the sophisticated chromatic adjustment with which the Renaissance composers endowed their vocal counterpoint.
Spring returns,
the young and the gay, with flowers wreathed and gay. returns, the song of joy recalling. Morning returns, the song of joy recalling, the song of joy recalling.
Well, these are the devices from which fugue is descended, but they don't constitute fugue of themselves, because although the climate for contrapuntal craft was ideal in the Renaissance, it was the specific harmonic character of Baroque music which gave to the fugue its finest hour. It was the behavior pattern expected of music operating within a key signature which introduced new plateaus of modulation in which the subjects and their counter-subjects could amuse themselves and through which the architecture of the fugue as we know it took on a coherent balance. When we hear a fugue like the one in E-flat by Bach, which I'm going to play now, we hear a composition which not only disciplines four profoundly beautiful lines, but which makes them more compelling by having them work within a superbly disciplined harmonic regime. Let me play it for you. That fugue was basically a very simple one. In it, the subject always appeared in its original form whenever it was heard from. I'm going to play one now, which is a much more intense fugue, and in which the subject... ...goes through all sorts of complicated disguises, such as this inversion. And this combination of the subject and its inversion together. All Altogether, I think this is one of the finest of Bach's fugues.